who was at Princeton University, and he was sort of the first one to lay down foundations of sustainable architecture. He says that natural systems has their capacities, and we may not be able to solve all the problems with the natural system, but our aim should be to bring out the best of the natural system. Suppose if I have a shading tree, I should utilize that to the best. I cannot resolve everything with the natural system, but I can bring out the best possibilities. So we will see what are those best possibilities with the natural system. And connecting with my earlier lecture on the day one, when I discussed about the various institutional framework, I would like to recall the Agenda 21, which was the first institutional framework towards sustainable architecture. And it says that construction industry should utilize the indigenous local material and technologies, labor intensive construction, maintenance technologies, energy efficient designs, technologies, sustainable utilization of natural resources, development of knowledge on environmental impact of buildings, and self-help housing for urban and rural poor. So this was the first international manifesto which was related directly to built environment, and this also states the same thing which Olga has said in 1960s, that we should bring out the best of the natural possibilities and whatever is locally available to us. So as Dr. Paula last lecture has explained about the methodology for built environment sustainability and quality of life, she has discussed about that what are the aspects associated with the natural systems, which include site topography, land and soil quality, local geology, potential for use of local material, local macro and micro climate, solar, wind and hydro and ground source heating, cooling and other potential sources of low carbon and renewable energy, and also about integrated agriculture and landscape, access to water, rainwater, site drainage, wastewater treatment and disposal, conserving and improving local biodiversity, protected species, habitats and habitat connectivity, waste disposal and composting. So this is what is the natural system can help us in achieving in sustainable built environment. So starting with the site, Ian McHugh in 1969, in his classical book Design with Nature, he has given a comprehensive study of how buildings can be integrated in the natural context by using the natural system. And in fact, this book pioneered the concept of ecological planning, and he talked about forming the layers. See, every site you take up, yesterday you have been to a site visit and you have seen a site, apparently everything looked perfect. In fact, I was told by Dr. Paula, one of the participants, said that everything is perfect. What is the intervention we can do? See, we have to make a informed decision. Instead of just looking at intuitively or saying that everything is perfect, we should have a database to assert what we are saying. So for that, we need to have all the information which is required. And what Ian McHugh has said, that you should form layers of various aspects of the site. So if it is topography will form one of the layer. This is from his diagrams. If it is about vegetation, it will form one layer. If it is about any kind of water bodies, etc., you can form a layer of that, and all these layers can be then superimposed on each other to know the potentials of the site. So this is a very systematic process of analyzing. We have been doing, all of you are building professional, and you have gone through this courses of site planning and all, and we have done some of this, but this is a very intricate systematic procedure of doing a site analysis. You should form layers of different attributes of the site and then superimpose them, because if you want to put everything together, you may not be able to get the correct picture. You may not be able to do a SWOT analysis of the site. So that is what is the idea here, that you should do it individually, every aspect, and then work out what is the best and which can help you in designing a sustainable built environment. Then you you can also look at the site, wind directions, you can look at the sun, solar movement with respect to the site. You can superimpose the all the natural elements like sun and wind, etc. on the site, and you can see how it also helps you in making the decision, informed decision about the sustainable built environment. And now coming to the very larger picture, that is the micro and macro climate, which has a direct bearing on the comfort condition, thermal, visual and oral conditions of occupants of the building. And this has to be again superimposed, that you have to understand what is the potentials of your site, what are the natural elements, microclimate, macroclimate, and then what is the human comfort requirement, because these two things are something which designer cannot alter. Designer has nothing to alter in the microclimate or macroclimate. Maybe he can do some interventions at the microclimate level, but macroclimate is as it is. It is a natural system which is available. Then comfort conditions required are also governed by the human requirement, whatever is subjective requirement of the human. We may take a average of 80% preference, people's preference, or 90% people's preference, but this is also given to us. So these two things are given to us: the climatic condition, the comfort requirement, and we have to map these two together. We have to superimpose these two together. Then only we can work out what is the sustainable design strategy which is appropriate for the given situation. So it's also a very systematic process of analysis and decision making. So if we look at the micro level, there are a number of climate. In fact, Köppen classification is one of the very extensive and still a very standard classification, internationally accepted. Köppen was a biologist, and he had in St. Petersburg, he had evolved this classification, and which has been modified by subsequently by Geiger, and now also it is acceptable across the globe. And he has given, there are 31 types of climate which is shown here with different appellations and nomenclature or coding, and this is the world map which shows how these climates are. And you can see that there is different climate in different regions of the world, and that itself means that we will have to appropriately give response. The built form cannot be ubiquitous, it has to be climate responsive of the given place. And in India, as I already explained in my last lecture, that we have a classification which is given by Bureau of Indian Standard, and we have five climatic zones. And if we look at the traditional and indigenous architecture of these places, they have also evolved in response to these respective climates. So once we have all the climatic data, this is the extensive climatic data we may get access to as an architect when you are evolving design strategy. That time we may not be looking at a very TMY or TRY kind of reference year climatic data, but we will be looking at some of the indicative data so that you can classify the climate of that place and you can make appropriate design decisions in the formative stages. And once you have evolved an appropriate design, you may go for a detailed simulation with the help of computer software, etc. But this is the basic information where I have shown you that we can have some numbers. The numbers do not directly give us any decision making information, but if we put the same numbers in the graphical form, suppose if I want to put the sunshine duration in the graphical form, this will give me a clear picture that how is the performance of the sun movement and how is the solar radiation on the given place. And then these are the windrose diagram, which also indicates the wind direction and intensity of wind. By looking at this diagram, it clearly depicts that the prevailing wind direction is north, because this is based on the cardinal and semi-cardinal directions. Similarly, all other climatic data, if you look at, you will know the temperature pattern, the humidity, rainfall, etc. So we can graphically display this data, we can give an analysis, and then there are some indices which also gives us a picture that how the climate varies throughout the day and throughout the year. So if we look at the diurnal range, that is what is the average diurnal range, that means what is the temperature difference between day and night, we will understand that how much is the difference between morning and the late afternoon temperature. And then annual mean range means that what is the difference between the winter and summer, how much variation happens in the temperature. So that is a very important aspect for us decision making with respect to the climate. So if there are not large diurnal variations, if there are not large annual variation, that means we will have to design a form which will be applicable similar, will perform similarly throughout the year. But there are some climate where there are extremities in summer and winter. So we need to understand that. I will explain with further illustrations. And looking at the microclimate, see, microclimate of a place may be governed by the topography, the site features, if there are any water bodies, if there are vegetations. So by that there may be a modification in the microclimate, and we may read this data along with the macroclimatic data, because microclimatic data you may not obtain throughout the year because there are limitations of time. So you may judge during some of the seasonal variations, and looking at the features of the site, you can arrive at certain judgment. Based on that, you can analyze the microclimate. And the key design issues we will be looking at is thermal comfort, daylighting, passive solar heating, passive cooling, solar control design, acoustics and air quality, based on what information we get about the natural system of our site. So looking at the bioclimatic chart of Olgay, which was the first kind of depiction of all the parameters of temperature, humidity, radiation, and he had shown that the comfort lies within this particular zone, and it was related with the human comfort requirement, and that is why it is known as bioclimatic chart. So he had mapped this on the a scale, which is vertical, is showing the temperature in Fahrenheit, and this is showing the humidity here. Sorry, this is showing the humidity in percent, relative humidity in percentage. So he showed that this is the particular zone where people will be comfortable. But if we provide little air movement, the comfort zone can be extended. If we provide air solar heating, then the comfort zone can be also brought down. People can accept lower temperature if there is a passive solar heating. That means we allow the sun in. So that is how the bioclimatic looked at the possibilities of extending the thermal comfort zone by making some changes in the built environment. Then it was further taken up then ASHRAE, which is an American Society of Heating and Air Conditioning and Refrigerating Engineers. They evolved their comfort zone on psychrometric chart. All of you may be aware, psychrometric chart shows a relationship between the basic parameters, that is the relative humidity, temperature, and all absolute humidity, wet bulb temperature, enthalpy, etc. So the ASHRAE showed the comfort zone for winter and summer. So these are the two comfort zone for winter and summer, and it said that 90% people can be satisfied if this kind of ambient conditions are maintained. And then there have been software developed across the many universities, and this is one of the software climate consultant which came up in University of California. It did with, because it was done with the computer, so it can do very detailed analysis. It maps all your temperature data with respect to the comfort zone for different type of climatic conditions, and strategies, passive strategies you may adopt. And if we look at some of the extreme climate, as I mentioned, that diurnal range may not be high. So Mumbai is a place, it's a warm, humid climate, and you can see if you map the winter and summer comfort zone, they overlap. That means there is not much variation from winter or summer or highest or lowest. That means the range is very small. Throughout the year, the climate remains, comfort requirement remains more or less same. But if you look at Jaipur, which is falling in the composite zone of India, in that you can see the winter comfort zone is to the left side. It's very distinct from the summer comfort zone. That means there is a large diurnal variation, and we have different comfort requirement with the winter and summer. So you have to look at the given place. Like suppose if you are doing for Sonipat, you can plot these kind of comfort zone, winter and summer comfort zone for Sonipat, for the given site you are analyzing in your tutorials, and then you can map all the 12 months temperature against this to find out what is the climatic problem here and what kind of design intervention will resolve those extremities. And then if we are looking at the daylighting, that is providing daylighting in the building. This is also coming from your side, so you have to analyze your site with respect to the sun movement and direct and diffuse daylighting. So we can look at the beneficial sky resource that is generically available and see that how we can give it with respect to the site. If you look at the site, there may be some vegetation, there may be existing building. If it is an urban setting, you may have buildings around it. So you have to analyze that how much of the sky is seen from your particular given site, because that will govern the amount of daylight available on your site. Right now we are not putting any building, we are trying to analyze what is the natural possibilities with our site. So your site, if it is existing in an urban setting, that is why we gave you a location where there is some development around you. So you may analyze that how much of the sky hemisphere is visible from your site. That will give you an idea that what are the daylighting possibilities in your project. So you can see if there are any hills, mountains around, or any blocking, you can analyze that and you can show that this is the portion which will not receive the daylight and which is the portion best location for your building where you will get the adequate daylight. So this is something which in one of the project in Hong Kong, they had done the analysis. They had designed the facade to work with the path of the sun and also to permit daylight entry. It was an urban setting, because Hong Kong, you know, it's a just like our Mumbai or Singapore, these places, it's highly built, it's an urban space. So in that all around there are developments, so they had to design for daylighting as well as for solar photovoltaic cell. So they had oriented the building towards the equator, and this was the analysis they found, and they even did little bit of curvature, gave little bit of curvature to the building so that it is following the it is getting maximum sun. So this was the analysis which was done with respect to the sun movement for the daylighting purposes, also for harnessing the solar energy for electricity generation, etc. So this is some more sketches of the architects and their analysis, how they will and what strategies they will adopt for lighting. You can see they have mentioned that we can have lighting shelves, there could be active facade system, and there could be landscape roof, and what kind of sun breakers can be so that we avoid the direct sun, which is not desirable inside Hong Kong. You can imagine it is near equator, so it is a warm humid climate, and in warm humid climate the best thing is to have all the air movement and overhead canopy. You should avoid the direct sun. So that is how their strategies evolved. And then if we are looking at what are the possibilities of passive solar heating on your site, this is applicable in case of cold climate. So in this we are looking at possibilities of having the direct sun. We would like the direct sun to be in. One of the quality of direct sun getting through the windows is that it is shortwave infrared radiation. It gets inside through the glass and it heats up inside, and that is one of the very simplest strategy of passive solar heating. So here I should orient my openings of the building towards the sun, especially southern sun in case of northern hemisphere, and we can work out the balance point temperature, which is a little intricate concept. We may not touch upon this. So we can work out what is the balance point temperature for heating design and during the underheated period, and then we can look at what is the sun part movement on that side, what is the site characteristic, are there any obstruction to the sun, and how we can remove those obstruction or evade, or they have to be moved out. So this is a analysis for Leh Ladakh, where it's very extreme cold climate, and it's a cold dry, it's kind of a desert climate. In that the temperatures are going very less, as you can see here. These are the 12 months temperature which have been plotted, and this is the comfort zone. So very few time of the year the temperature ambient temperatures are within the comfort zone. Most of the time they are outside the comfort zone, they are cold. And that is the place where you have to adopt the passive solar heating strategy. That means sun can heat inside. And this is these are the various strategies which can be adopted for passive solar heating. That is just having a simple window facing towards the equator. And this is the direct gain, this is known as direct gain system. Then Trombe-Mitchell wall, which is named after the inventor. And in this you have a mass, you have a thermal mass here, and you have a space in between, and then there is a glazing. In this we keep some vents here. There are vents in this as well as in this. So during the summer months, winter months, the sun solar radiation passes through this glass. It heats up this space, and then in exchange it heats up the this mass, and then this mass re-radiate that heat inside, and then the air which is cool goes through this vent out, and this get heated up, and it gets circulated inside. And this mass helps in when there is no sun. See, if I have direct sun during the daytime, it just works that you are moving the air in. What about in the night? In the night there is no sun. So whatever heat is stored in this thermal mass, that get re-radiated inside during the night time. So if you have to design a space which has to be used 24/7 or day and night, in that case you can use such systems where there is a possibility that when there is no sun also you can get the heating effect. And if it is a space which is meant for direct only daytime use, you can use the direct gain windows. And then there are been further innovation, greenhouse concepts have come up, where this space which was there in Trombe-Mitchell wall is extended so that people can sit out here and they can relax and use this space also. So this becomes a usable space. So there have been a lot of variations and innovations. So these kind of strategies one can decide on. I'll give you example of this is the drug white lotus school designed by Oweorup from UK. And in this extreme climate of Leh Ladakh, they have used this passive solar heating concepts, and they have used different strategies. For the classroom, they have used the direct gain system. But in the hostels where the students are living, they are not there in the daytime. So they have used direct gain with mass. So whatever heat is stored during the daytime when the kids go for sleeping in the their dormitories, that heat is available, the thermal mass, it re-radiates that. Traditionally also there have been lot of examples in our country regarding the thermal mass, so I can show you that later. Regarding passive cooling, if we are into a warm climate and tropical climate, there we will like to see what are the natural possibilities of passive cooling. So in this we may look at the wind pattern. So if ventilation is required, the climate demands ventilation, then we'll look at the wind pattern. We will orient the opening such that the wind movement is facilitated through the built spaces. And we'll look at the ambient wet bulb temperature if cooling is to be by adiabatic means, that is by evaporative cooling. And access to night sky if we want that whatever heat is stored in the mass can be re-radiated to the sky, or it can be used as a sink. The sky can be used as a heat sink, or the soil can be used as this building where you are having the lectures. It is cooled by the EAT, earth air tunnel. So in this what we are doing, we are using earth as the sink. So whatever heat is there from outside, the air is coming through the air tunnels, and then only after that only temperature downs, and that is treated by the air conditioning system, and then it is circulated inside. So here we are using the concept of heat sinks, and then we can achieve the passive cooling. And then this also we have to do a lot of analysis of the macro and micro climate, and we have to understand EAT may be proposed, but you have to do the calculation, what are the outside temperature, what temperature you want the air in, and according to that the design of the duct, the cross section, etc. area has to be done on the basis of fluid dynamics. So this is a mass effect again concept in Jodhpur, where there is extreme climate. Winter is extreme, summer is extreme. So here thermal mass is very helpful in winter as well as in summer. So by this we can extend the comfort zone. This study is the method of doing this can be looked through some of the textbook. I can share that later after the lecture. So the basic concept is that we are using the mass of the building for storing the heat and reusing it, or for getting the depletion in the heat transmission. And traditionally we have seen mass effect in case of desert climate of Rajasthan, where there were havelis which had massive construction. In fact, their walls used to be 1 meter thick, made out of adobe, and the roof also is made out of adobe, which has also mass. And you can see this is study by Dr. Vinod Gupta. He has used he has found that there is a 45 centimeter thick roof, which is all filled up with the earth, and there is a timber beam below it, and there are some grass mat as the roofing material use. So they worked very well, and even the build form evolved in response to the climate. There was compact planning. This is something which I did a study with my intern from Greece. So these are the islands which are known as Cyclades Island. There are 200 plus islands, and in this the construction is very unique, and they are amazingly beautiful. They are enjoying preservation status. Government do not allow to alter their architectural characteristics. So they are all white. You might have seen it in many of the movies also, these islands. So we just did a study of these islands, that how they performed climatically and how they are sustainable, because they were isolated from the mainland. So whatever was material available, locally available material on these islands, were the volcanic earth. There were some dead volcanoes, so the people had some of the slates, stone was available for construction. They were short trees, that is not more than 3 meter high trees, they were available for construction, and this volcanic earth. So with that they had evolved a very beautiful form, and you can see this is all very fortified kind of settlement. So for the purpose of protection from the enemies, as well as for the protection from the extremities of the climate, because the wind used to blow from the northern side. Heavy, the climate chart which I showed you, the northern wind is for these islands. So they had protected their houses. They were all in a group and fortified kind of settlement. If we look at the warm humid climate, where nothing gives you comfort than just the ventilation, air movement. And this is the climate we are experiencing now. Dr. Paola, it is her first visit to our country, and when she was in the guest house, she told me that I like to have this fan. I said, because this is the climate at this moment is warm humid, it's a monsoon period for us, and in this climate nothing will be giving you comfort than little air movement around your body. So if we look at the coastal areas of our country, Mumbai, Chennai, Trivandrum and all, I have also lived quite some time in these places. Their only thing you require is wind movement. And wind movement can be achieved through various provisions in the built environment. But when we are studying the climate of the place, we need to understand the wind rose diagrams. How is the direction of the wind? What is the intensity of the wind? And sometimes the solar orientation and the wind orientation are in conflict, because if you look at the western coast of India, Mumbai, Trivandrum and all such places, it is on the west side. So west sun is not desirable inside, but the wind also comes from the west. So they are both in the conflict. So I had seen in places in Manipal, Mangalore and all, we had no choice than to keep the western southwest window open, though it is not from the solar point of view, it is not desirable. So the strategy in this case happens that you provide adequate protection from the sun, but keep the window open, because this is the only passive strategy acceptable in this climate. So by ventilation, we can take up even extremes of humidity. This green is showing that what are the comfort possibilities with ventilation on psychrometric chart. So even the traditional built form, this is in Napier Museum, which I studied in Trivandrum, and you can see this was by foreign architect, and you see that he has adopted the elements of traditional architecture and incorporated in this museum, and you see the lot of openings, and this was a pavilion or outside, and this is the kind of, it just exemplifies that this is the kind of built form suitable in this climate. If you look at the house also in these region, the traditional houses also, they will have a deep overhang veranda all around the house and lot of opening all four sides of the house, so the wind can flow through in, and you have the protection from the direct sun. And in the hot dry climate, like extreme climate of Jodhpur and Rajasthan, besides mass effect, evaporative cooling also is very helpful because their humidities are very low. So if you look at this, this is the study of Jodhpur climate. In this, the humidity are very low, and in this we can adopt the evaporative cooling. Evaporative cooling can be by various means. I've just shown the basic diagram here. Direct evaporative cooling, all of us are aware about the desert cooler, where you have the humid air which is coming through the pad, which are kept wet, and that is flows. In this we may be increasing is that you may have a roof pond over it, so by which the temperatures will come down and automatically inside will be cooler. So there are variations of these strategies, but these are the basic two fundamental way of doing evaporative cooling. And this is one of the modern example, and in this they have adopted evaporative cooling, and they have used the passive downdraft evaporative cooling system in Torrent Research Center in Ahmedabad, which is a very extreme hot dry climate. You can experience 45 temperature in the summer. So this research lab, and this is being monitored also, there are data available for this, and it functions. Sometimes it may happen that you may propose strategies, but then if you are not monitoring and confirming that this is actually working, then it is of no use for the future design concepts. So in this they have monitored, some of the Australian architects, they monitored it, and they found that this strategy works. So these towers which you see, they function like this. So there is a evaporative cooling, there is an inlet through these, and it is through the moisture is added to this tower, and the hot wind can go out, exhaust from there. So this is what, and they have worked out on the cost effectiveness also, because which is economic aspect of any sustainable strategies. So they did the payback period calculation, and it was found that within few years this system will pay back whatever extra cost has been incurred on this constructing these towers. And then one of the important strategy in case of tropical climate, even in temperate climate, is the solar control. Solar control is essential even in temperate climate, reason being that glass is transparent for this infrared solar radiation. It allows the solar radiation inside, but when the inside get heated up, the emissions which is happening from the inside surfaces is long wave infrared radiation, and glass is not transparent for that. As a result, what happens, whatever heat comes in, it gets trapped inside, and it has no way out, and the temperature keep rising. There was a very interesting study of Kabuzier's one of the project of Salvation Army in France, in Paris. In that Kabuzier has, because it's a temperate climate, Kabuzier has proposed all glass facade in that building, and no ventilation was provided. The building was inaugurated in sometime in December around Christmas, and it was cold that time, and it worked very well. People found the interior were very warm, so there was all applause for Kabuzier. But when summer came, it became a kind of inferno. It became a furnace, because the solar heat got trapped inside, and people complained, and in fact he was sued, and then he had to alter his design and include ventilators in the facade. And that was the one of the learning for Kabuzier, and his later part of his architecture in India, you find he has used extensively brisk solar control design. So solar control is very essential. The point I want to emphasize to all of you is that you need to design for solar control, and all your ratings, Griha rating, etc., they also emphasize on this, that you have to design, you get points for this, etc. So solar control can be achieved by some of the passive strategies. One is keeping the orientation and window size. You can orient your building, avoid the site which is west, where hot sun is there. If it is not possible, then as I told, in warm humid climate, you may have to extensively work on the solar control design. Window size is also a matter now, because energy conservation building code, earlier in 2007, they had given a limit of 60% wall window ratio. Wall window ratio is your facade, whatever area of the facade and the area of it is ratio between that. So now in the 2017, it has been brought to 40%. So in our climate, in our country, they have mentioned that you have to maintain that not more than 40% of facade is having the windows. So this is window size also is very important. Then the other strategy is just internal blinds, curtains, but may not be effective to that extent as other strategies, because you are allowing the sun in and then you are trying to put curtains or blinds and all. So this may still make it hotter near to the windows and all. Then we had a range of high performance glasses, external shading devices, etc. So orientation is, this is how you decide on that, how you can orient the windows, size of the window. If it is avoidable, you can reduce the size. I'll show you how architects have done their own interpretations of orientation and window sizes. So see, windows are also there for the daylighting. So we have to trade off between these two requirements, that is solar control and the daylighting. We cannot compromise on the daylighting also. Window size, area, etc. So it can be various ratios, and as I told you that right now it is a 40%, we cannot exceed as per the energy conservation building code. Then there are range of high performance glasses, and they have different U values, SHGC is shading heat gain coefficient, and which is nothing but it says that how much of the solar radiation which is falling on the window will get inside. So different type of glasses are available for the architects who fancy for the facade without any shading devices. And if we have to design the shading devices, which is a time tested solution, and it works throughout the year, and I'll show you how in some examples. So for that we have to do some analysis. We have to take the sunpath diagrams of the given place and map the overheated period. Overheated period means when the temperature, ambient temperatures, are above the comfort zone. So that period you have to map on the sunpath diagram. In fact, Griha has given unique kind of overheated period. They said from this period to April to September, they have given the dates. Within that period only we have to cut off the sun, but it may vary. They are working on it and they may come up with precise calculation for given city, but this is a analysis which can be done by yourself for your given city, that when the temperatures are above the comfort zone, we would not like to have the sun in. And then you can work out with the shading devices. There are various tools now, computer assisted tools are also there. You can do the computer analysis manually also you can do, which is a very age-old way of doing it. You can have the shadow protector, you can decide on the vertical and horizontal shadow angles, and you can find the shading mask to decide what kind of shading strategy will work on the given window situation. And these are some of the unique solutions which I came across. This is a building in Singapore, and Singapore is 1 degree latitude. It is just near to equator. So you can imagine that throughout the year the temperatures are more or less similar. It's a warm humid climate, equatorial climate, and there is no winter concept there. In fact, some of the kids in the school ask, they when they study there are different seasons, so they ask their mother that what is winter. Mother has no experience because they are not experiencing. So this is a climate where I have already mapped it on this sunpath diagram, that throughout the year, this is the climatic data from Changi Airport, that throughout the year it is hot, it is above comfort zone. So that means I have to cut off the sun throughout the year. which is a very challenging task. And Paul Rudolph, who is an American architect, he came up with a very unique solution that if we tilt the windows, he has tilted them at 60 degree, and he has worked on a polygonal form of the building. This was a mixed-use development. And with this tilted window, I had worked out with my software what is the efficiency. With 60% angle, he was getting shading efficiency about 80%. So this worked really well there. And in fact, I personally visited also. So you will not get the direct sun during the daytime, but at the same time, you have adequate daylight. This was an office tower, and adequate daylight was available throughout the year. This is another intervention by the architects. See, architects are innovating different part of the world. There are many examples of shading devices, and this I will like to show because it shows that our window size shading devices can be articulated as per the orientation, as per the solar movement, to give the best of the possibilities of solar movement. So this is in the southern hemisphere in Australia, in Brisbane. This building has a different angle of shading. We know that there is a horizontal shading devices straight, but this building has inclined shading devices, and they are at different angles. And on the western side, which was facing the street, this river, this center is facing actually river, and they have taken a triangular form. Triangular form means both the sides of the triangle will get a river view. And it's a beautiful view. Only one of the side was facing toward the street, that was west. So on the western side, the architect has reduced the size of the height of the window. So that is how he controlled the solar sun movement inside, or solar radiation penetration inside, and he got the adequate daylight as well as the best view which is possible from these window. So this is a very unique design intervention by the architect. And then this is a classical example. I never like to miss on this. This is Mill Owners Association building in Ahmedabad, and Ahmedabad, all of you know, is on the banks of Sabarmati River. So on the west side is the new Ahmedabad, and on the other side is the old part. So now this is on the Ashram Road. This building is on the Ashram Road facing west, and this picture I have taken at around 4 o'clock in the evening. You can see how intense sun is falling on the building facade. And see, Kabuzier has given a unique solution. He has given the vertical fins inclined at an angle so that direct sun coming from the west can be intercepted. So this is a very time-tested solution and a unique solution for that given situation, because there was no possibility for him to change the orientation. As an architect, you might come across a situation, though west may not be the best orientation, but you have to face, because the street was facing on this side and there has to be an entrance, the facade of the building has to be on this side. So he has evolved a very innovative solution for intercepting the direct solar radiation. And then there are acoustic requirement also. You may analyze in your site. Yesterday you have seen a site where are urban setting, and you may have the movement of the traffic and all. You may like to have sound insulation, or you may like to use the natural features as sound insulation. So you can see that what are the sources of noise in your site, and how you can use the site potentials for giving you insulation from that, or protection from those noise. So you can even sometimes they are time dependent. They may be during the day, sometime this noise may be happening some of the time, of because now we live near to the highway, and I find that in the during the night time when we are living in our houses, I hear the truck every time. If I go home also, I miss this truck noise keep haunting me, because I'm so used to this truck noise. So you have to see that in abroad and all, we have sound barriers for such highways, etc., or motorways. Air quality is also very important. On our campus, we have done some measurements of air quality, and this is very important for us because our sustenance depends on this. So you can measure this air quality. There are sensors, CO2 sensors are available, and which can be used to see that how your site air quality is there, and if there are interventions required for improving the air quality. And then looking at the renewable energy sources, because we would also like to make a sustainable built environment, we will see what are the natural possibilities of using the renewable sources of energy. And all of you know that sun is one of the major source of all energy, and this taxonomy of solar energy is very extensive. It shows that what could be the direct application of solar energy. One is for thermal, which I told you, passive solar heating. It can be used for electrical energy also through photovoltaic cell or thermoelectric cells. It can be also used through the biochemical, that is natural plants and algae, biomass, they can be also converted into energy by with the help of the sun. Whatever photosynthesis happen, all the natural life goes to that, and that biomass can be used for producing energy. So you can have active and passive system. There are various passive system, active systems which will incorporate some kind of use of energy, but they are low on energy. And indirect application is the wind movement, which also happens because of the sun, and hydro applications and oceans, wave, etc. This can be harnessed for renewable sources of energy. And this is another way of explaining it, that there are non-solar energy applications also, which can be used. Geothermal, the ground can be used for non-solar application. Waste can be converted into energy. Fuel cell technology can be used for energy production. These are the new sources of energy. And coming to now integrating the agriculture with your landscape, and all of us are aware that there are enormous possibility. Urbanization is going at a vast rate globally. If you look at it, 50% is urbanized. Our country is still not, but we are also on the way of urbanization, and it is expected that we may have 60% urbanization in our country. So that means what will happen, our agricultural land, and all of you may, some of the studies shows that agricultural land are converted into urban centers, and they are built upon. So we are losing that land which provides us sustenance, which provide us food. So there have been attempts in various places, various cities, of urban farming, that they are integrating agriculture with the landscape. So whatever landscaping elements you have in urban spaces, they can be used for agriculture purpose, and that is known as urban farming and all. So this is some examples. Curitiba is one of the very good example, and we can see that 5 to 20% of world's fruit produces in cities, and these are some of the statistics regarding the urban agriculture. And these are the examples of urban farming, that how can you design your spaces, green spaces, which are part of your urban setting. They can be used as now farms. They can produce food purposefully. They can be leased out and all. And I think I discussed with Paola some examples. She said people can take it. There is no one to sell it. All those urban farm is available for you to take it. So this is some examples. This is in Hong Kong again. And there are some more examples where people, it serves as an educative purpose also. Even for the progeny who are only aware that the fruits and the vegetable come from the market, for them also it is educative, that how does these things grow, and how important this is for their life sustenance. So this is serving the dual purposes. So many such examples are there. And there is a book also on how urban farming can be used as a landscaping element. So your site planning can be integrating these concepts. You can, whichever project you work on, that you can look at the possibilities of urban farming in your given site. These are also some examples. Coming to now the water, which is one of the very important resource, and there is a scarcity. All of us know that potable water is only 1%, and second issue is poor quality of water, and there are third thing is water related disaster. We, in spite of all this, we still have the flood situation in many parts of the world. So these are the major concerns related to water as per the UNESCO report. And if we look at the global freshwater excess, so you can see that this figures are showing that less than 1000 cubic meter per person. And if we look at our country, we fall within this 1000 to 1700 cubic meter per person. So this is something which is, we are on the verge of water starving country. Africa, you can see already is very less, and this is alarming for us. So water is one of the very important resource for us, and we have to conserve it at whatever situation, given situation you are working on. So you have to look at the possibilities of water conservation in your site. And all of us know the water cycle, which we studied in school. So this is just to refresh your memory that how, from where water comes. And Honorable Vice Chancellor in his inaugural address also said that H2 and O becomes water, or is it through the trees and all the natural systems the water comes. So it's obviously through the natural system, and they are our important resource. And as building professional for sustainable building design, we need to look at possibilities of conserving water and catchment of water, preserving it and using it in the best possible way. So urban, if you look at the urban settings where the vegetation has been removed, drainage patterns changes, and there is lot of natural loss of natural depressions, rainfall absorbing capacity of the soil is reduced, and impervious area. So now in our national building code also there are conditions given that how much should be the imperviousness of your site, and the man-made drainage system, urban sewers, etc., they also contribute to disturbing our water cycle. And in our capacity as building professional, we have to look at the various possibilities. Interception of rainfall is reduced due to removal of trees. Precipitation is usually higher in rural areas. Evapotranspiration is much lower, and surface runoff is much larger. And groundwater runoff, infiltration, recharge is small. Water storage is much smaller. Runoff volumes, peak flow in rivers are higher. Frequency of surface runoff is increased. And if we compare the rural and urban setting with respect to water, we see that our hard surfaces, the design we do for streets, etc., is affecting the water conservation. Water flows to the low parts and it just drains away through these cities. So we have to avoid that. We have to lessen this. And there are different way of analyzing it. So considering that it is a limited resource, we must analyze that what is our water requirement. So we have to first study what is our water demand, and throughout the day per capita, and towards what uses it goes. So you can make an analysis with respect to your given project. And then see the kind of grades of the water used in the building, the potable water, clear water, rain water, grey water, dark grey water and black water. So these are the gradation, and they can be used in different purposes. And you can see that how the water is recycled and reused in your given projects. So key architectural issue will be that high grade potable water should be for this kind of task, low grade for other task you can use it. So you will use the recycled water to reduce the overall water uses. So you can reduce the demand, and then you can have rainwater harvesting also to supplement your water requirement. So this is the kind of breakup analysis you can do for your requirement, that what is the potable water required and what is the recycled water required, the component of each, and total percentage you can work out. And then depending on the number of occupancy, you can work out your water demand. And then water and stormwater runoff, which happens from the site. So you have to meet water needs from on-site resources, try to ensure and gauge the potential of such strategies which require understanding of rainfall rate. In fact, there was an interesting anecdote when we had an examiner from IIT Delhi. IIT Delhi wanted to build some additional hostels. because as their intake is increasing, they wanted to build up more hostels. So they went to environmental clearance. So they were laid down a condition that you have to make sure that you do not require additional water from the municipal, and you also do not drain off additional water to the municipal drain. So you will not demand more water and you will not also dispose of water in the municipal drain. So you have to show us the design, making sure that whatever additional building you are making, there will be no stress on the existing infrastructure. Then only you will get environmental clearance. So IIT had to evolve the solution that their demand is reduced, and whatever their demand is, they will meet from the renewable sources of water or whatever rainwater harvesting, etc. And they are recycling whatever wastewater is there. So they convinced, then only they got the environmental clearance. So that's going to happen in future in urban setting, because our infrastructure is built, and if we add on to that, it may not be able to take care of. And further, we may not be able to provide this precious resource. So they evolved a solution. They had evolved some, in fact, they have patented also waterless urinals for hostels and all. So these kind of various strategies they adopted, and they convinced the environmental for environmental clearance. So this is very important in any of the projects. So you can look at what are the requirements and what are the conservation opportunities, that how you can preserve or reserve the high quality water for high grade task, and reduce the flow in the fixture. So all of you are aware now, this is norm of the day, so everybody knows that what are the low fixtures and all. So accessible water for you is precipitation, the runoff which is happening, the soil moisture and the groundwater table also can be considered. Site selection is also very important from the point of view of water. All of us know historically all civilization happened along the banks of river, and because water is required for sustenance. So if we take care of these resources and whatever health issues we have with the marshy land, etc., we have over the years evolved the technology which removes the water to the river, which is not desirable, and it is also causing the flooding, etc., in the downstream. So there could be various strategy that we can have the green roofs which can do the retention of water. At the same time, it will act as a thermal mass for passive cooling, etc. We can have porous pavement surfaces so that water is it percolates inside the ground and recharges it. And site can be designed for recharging. You can have bioswales, etc., water channels. In fact, this works very effectively. Last year, we visited Infosys campus in Hyderabad. They have very strategically laid down bioswales in their campus, and all the water is then taken to the catchment area at the backside of the site. So from even from the rooftop, the water is drained into this bioswell. So these are the trenches with the with vegetation on it, so they are not hard kind of trenches, and this little absorbs water also. It drains off the excess water to whatever catchment area you would like to take. And this is a very good example of water conservation, which is in Texas, Austin, Lady Bird Johnson Wildflower Center, where they have used xeriscaping, which is a concept of landscaping where minimal water or low water is used. And they have also very interesting strategies, which I'll show you for water conservation. So our purpose in water catchment is that we should have water conservation, reduce use of purchased water supply or from municipal sources, etc. Where should we collect the water? We have to coordinate with our site, the roof planes, etc., material, the storage location, and site analysis. You have to do what is the contour of your site, which are the lowest point and which are the highest point, where we can plan retention ponds. Like in Infosys, they had planned their retention ponds at the lowest point so that by natural grade, the water can flow to those catchment areas. And what is the local code requirement, etc. So we can have smaller systems for collecting water, roof water runoff, larger systems for like landform, etc. You can have the catchment. In fact, our National Building Code in Part 9, it gives the various strategies, and it also states that how this works, in which kind of situation you can. So you may have a look at various strategies of water conservation, which is under the landscape section. So these are the basic systems of water catchment, and most of us are aware of it. So we may have to look at the roof design, what kind of material we are using, because water, if it is to be collected from roof, then the surface material is important, because it should not contaminate or affect the quality of the water. So you have to see that what kind of roofing material you are using and whether it is appropriate for collection of the roof water runoff. And storage, what kind of storage systems you will have, and purification system. In fact, we did a very important interesting study for our campus. It was a part of a dissertation, and our university wanted that we should evolve a rainwater harvesting system for our campus. So we did a calculation of all the roof area available in the university, on the hostels, in the houses, etc. And we looked at the rainfall data of Sonipat, and we calculated what amount of water can be collected through these surfaces. And then we calculated the demand of the university, calculated the occupants of the university, number of students here. So we found that the amount of water which we will collect, and if we build a storage tank, etc., for keeping this rainwater, and we build a system, the demand can be only met for 4 days or 4 to 5 days. So it was not a very cost effective way of doing the rainwater harvesting. See, there was a similar study in IIT Powai. IIT Powai, they found that if they collect the rooftop water and store it in the tank, it can meet their demands for quite a few months. Reason being, the rainfall in Mumbai is very high compared to what it is in Sonipat. So see, every strategy cannot work everywhere. So you have to make a detailed analysis that what is the rainfall and what is the potential of your given project, and what kind of rainwater harvesting strategy will be. Can only have the water recharge systems. So we are already having some, and we are upgrading them, and we will have more of it, so that at every strategic point. I asked our university photographer that when there was a heavy rain, because if we did the contour analysis of our campus, we found it was absolutely flat. We did it through GIS, everything, and it was not really able to make out any much of level differences and all. So what I had to do was that I asked the photographer to take picture when there was a heavy rainfall one day. And I said, you go around in the campus and take pictures of the places where there is a water logging. So that's how we decided where we should locate these recharge pits. So this is something which you have to intelligently do based on the given situation. And everywhere we cannot think of that we will have the water storage systems, etc. So there are design procedures for working on this, how much rainfall happens, what should be the capacity of cisterns, etc., which you will require for keeping the storing the rainwater. So again, coming to this wildflower center in Texas Austin, they have also used very good architectural features for storing the water, rainwater. So this particular observation tower is also serving as the cistern for collecting rainwater. So this becomes an architectural feature and also serves for the rainwater harvesting. Then there is another project where they had used the recycled pickle barrels, and you can see similar kind of thing where across this highway, national highway, where the rice mills, and you see those silos. So similarly, they had used the pickle barrels and for as cisterns for storing rainwater. Now the last remaining topic is about the biodiversity analysis of your site, and biodiversity already Paula has discussed with you people, I'll just discuss what are the specific aspects of biodiversity which we have to, as an architect or building professional, keep in mind. And this includes genetic diversity, species diversity, community and ecosystem diversity. Diversity is very important from the ecological point of view. If we have similar kind of plantation in a given site, it is not very desirable, because they will be all taking the same nutrients from your soil, and eventually your soil will erode. So you have to have a mix of the various species. So there are this is known as the terminologies in this subject, that is species richness, species diversity. Species richness means one species, how much count you have. Now if you are taking a walk around our campus, you might see that on every tree there is a number given. In fact, we did a green audit of our campus. We found out that how many trees of what species are there, and we have sort of given them label. So you need to understand that how many types of species are there, that is species diversity. And then richness, that means it's how many number of each species are there. So if I have 25% of one species, another species, like that, if it is distributed like this, then we will say it is species rich. If suppose it is only 1% one particular species, then it is not species richness. So we should have species richness as well as species diversity. That means we should have various varieties of this, which is ecologically sustainable. So these are the points why biodiversity is important. It is ecosystem services, biological resources, it has a social benefit. And why it is important from the ecosystem services? It serves the purpose of protection of water resources, soil formation, nutrient storage and recycling, pollution breakdown, contribution to climate stability, maintenance of ecosystem, recovery from unpredictable events, etc. Biological resources, they provide us food, medicinal resources, they serve as wood for building, etc., ornamental plants, breeding stocks, and they serve as future resource. Diversity in genes, species and ecosystem are also very important. Social benefit, they serve the purpose of research, education and monitoring, recreation and tourism, and cultural values. So this is the importance of biodiversity. So we can do analysis of any given site with respect to biodiversity. Some of my students who are here, they have already done this exercise on our campus. So you can, whatever given site is there, you can look at it, and then you count the number of natural habitats on that site. So it may include 1, 2, 3, 4, and you can map them. They could be habitat means they should be homogeneous. That is, some habitat, like in this case, this meadow is homogeneous, so this forms one habitat. And then you should find out the number of species, count the number of species, and you should find out how many each species plant is there. So if it is going to any micro systems, then you can use this kind of grid, and within each grid you can map what type of species are there and what is their number. In fact, my students collected, I asked them to take even sample of leaf, etc. So we did this, and one of them made this grid also with the help of some wooden beams. So you can then identify that what is this species, what is its characteristic. And if you do not know the botanical name or their characteristics, you can refer to some of the standard sources and find out what is their characteristics, what is the leaf pattern, what is the, whether it is a evergreen or whether it is different variety, etc. So you can look at their characteristic, and then you can do the SWOT analysis. You can do the SWOT analysis with respect to this biodiversity study, that what is the strength, weakness, opportunities and threats in your site with respect to biodiversity. And that will form your understanding and your intervention of the built environment in harmony with the natural system. So you can note down the points. And for example, I can tell you that we have our people tree, which is a very unique, and you can find that everywhere in our country. It's also worshipped. So ancient mythology was also based on the natural system. They had chosen such plants which are beneficial for us. What is the unique feature about people tree? Anybody can tell me? Yes, she is right. Can you say it loud? Yeah, it releases oxygen. There are about 9 such trees which releases oxygen also. We all know that photosynthesis happen during the daytime, so they inhale CO2 and exhale oxygen. But many of the plants, they do not, this photosynthesis does not happen during the night. But in case of some of these 9, and people is one of that, which also releases oxygen in the night time. So it's a very beneficial tree for our sustenance. So our ancient belief were also based on this sustainability, natural systems, etc. And while doing the SWOT analysis, you can look at the characteristic of individual habitat, natural habitat on your site, and you can potentially use them, and you can then rectify or you can use to your benefit in the design. So your analysis can go, and you can do it in a very layer form, systematic form, and then you can come up with your design solutions for it. I would just like to mention one of the case study, which is something from the a corporate sector, but it's a unique venture, this project of Tata Consultancy Services, which all of you know, TCS firm. They had their project in Mumbai. It is in known as Banyan Park project. In the phase 1 project, in fact, this particular site had a chemical factory originally, and TCS bought it in 2002, and they had commissioned one of the sanctuary magazine to report on the flora and fauna, because it was very rich in flora and fauna. So they wanted to do an analysis, and they found there are 1800 trees on the site, and they, which is just a 22 acre land, and there are exotic as well as endemic kind of trees available on the site, and they had a very good habitat of butterfly, birds, snakes, bats, etc., which forms almost 14% of bird species found in Mumbai. So Tata originally wanted to make this campus for 6,000 employees. This point I would like you to note, that he wanted to build this campus for 6,000 employees. But looking at the biodiversity analysis of this project and the conservation decision which this company has taken, they reduced the capacity to 2,000. They say, we would rather preserve the biodiversity, flora, fauna of this site rather than build for 6,000 employees. So in fact, they reduced it to 2,000 employees, and they have preserved it very beautifully. Some only 400 trees they had to reinstall somewhere. They have preserved 1,400 trees, and they have in fact developed bat colonies. They have preserved that as a natural trail. Some of the spaces, there were some heritage buildings on the site, they have also been restored. They were not also pulled down, and they served as the guest houses for the their employees, etc. So this is a unique venture, and which shows that why it is so important. And this is what I wanted to, I have already told that they have even reduced their ground coverage, construction has been reduced, total capacity, and they have spotted what are the types of snakes there, and they have shifted them to the national park in Mumbai, and they have a bat colony on the, and which is known as no development zone. So this is something which is, they are preserving it. I think my lecture is getting a little longer. I'll just quickly go through this waste disposal. This is extensive topic, and these could be the waste disposal part of it, and we can go for the various treatment methods, biological and physical, chemical methods, which also depends. And living machine, already Paola had mentioned, this is a very wonderful system. It has been implemented in many of the projects, and it works very well. And this was the Public Utilities Commission building in San Francisco, where living machine uses purifies the wastewater. And this is also at Banyan Park. They are using vermi composting, biocomposting of the waste. So that's it. I think I am done. And if any questions, you can ask, or maybe we'll have Paola's lecture, and then we can go for questions. Your tea break is also delayed. Thank you very much.